changes in this perception, very significant changes in this perception in the second half of the 19th century. That's the point I started off with, the reaction against over-specialization that I was referring to. So this perception changed in the late 19th century. And what you find in the second half of the 19th century is that there was a strong tendency toward pure scholarship. It meant scholarship as produced and confined to specific disciplines. And this tendency gained momentum through German research universities, which emerged and set examples for specialized research in all areas of the arts and sciences. So German universities that first started off with these disciplinary learning, you know, in arts and sciences, you get trained within particular disciplines. So knowledge, you know, as scholarship as produced and confined to specific disciplines. And this was also a time when more and more American medical students and physicians were traveling to Germany to study in experimental laboratories or to get trained in clinical specialties. So they moved to Germany. They were mostly trained in German medical schools, and they were trained in experimental laboratories and also clinical specialties. You know, they underwent such training. And according to some of the historians of medicine, this new interest in clinical training resulted in the replacement of the old humanistic medicine with biomedical science, what we today understand as biomedical science. So some of the historians of medicine argue that this clinical training actually caused a replacement of the old humanistic tradition with biomedical science. And when these physicians, when these medical students who were trained in Germany, when they became a model in the United States, they brought back the German model to the new university medical schools in the United States. So this was accepted as a model for medical education. And then people began to advocate a new vision of medicine as an exact science. So medicine came to be treated as an exact science, very different from all other kinds of disciplines. So you have to, the doctor or the person who is undergoing training has to be confined to that particular field. And at the same time, though this was happening in the United States, that is towards the end of the 19th century, there were also people who were simultaneously worried about the whole, euphoria about specialization, clinical training and specialization, commercialism and moral drift that they felt, that the doctors were, they had moved away morally, and medicine was commercialized. And then specialization is actually destroying the humanistic element in medicine. You know, such concerns were being raised along the same time, around the same time. So we can probably argue that the seeds of medical humanities were sown by people like, people like William Osler, for example, a significant, early name, of course. He was not talking about medical humanities, of course, but the concerns that he was actually trying to raise. William Osler, who died in 1919, and John Shaw Billings, who died in 1913. Okay, so these people expressed concerns about science and business. They said they were worried about science and business taking the soul out of medicine. So they felt the soul of medicine is lost. But medical humanities in its current form began to take shape in the late 1960s, as I told you, in the late 1960s and early 1970s, at a time when academics in humanities disciplines in universities were increasingly suspicious of the term humanism and the curriculum of great books of the Western tradition. That's very interesting, And 60s and 70s, the period is very important for us, actually, right? That is a time of theoretical explosion, as we understand today. So theorists began to increasingly question the authenticity of humanist ideas. and how the great books of Western tradition were challenged by, you know, questions of post-colonial theory and all that, you know, but you need to recollect all that. So at that point of time, when humanist ideals were being challenged by academics, it is at that point of time that, you know, something like medical humanities is emerging. It's an irony. So because people were trying to say that the humanist tradition was a product of dead white men. You know, what you call the humanist tradition is a product of dead white men who had enjoyed all privileges, you know, who had privileged lives and who ignored questions of power and neglected issues of race, gender and class. And quite recently, we also speak about, you know, age and sexual orientation as well, you know, neglected. So that what you call as the humanistic tradition, as the grand tradition of Europe, is something that belongs to the dead white men who had all privileges and who ignored all these questions of power, sexual orientation, class, gender, and all that. So a critique of humanistic tradition that was emerging in the 60s and 70s. It is at that point that something like, you know, medical humanities, ironically, something like medical humanities is emerging. So the most prolific and influential proponent of medical humanism in this period was a person called Edmund Pellegrino. You know, Edmund Pellegrino is supposed to be a very significant figure. He you know, died only in 2013, actually. So he was a physician who occupied many important positions. He was a chair at the Institute on Human Values in Medicine, and also became president of Catholic University of America, and also served as chair of the President's Council on Bioethics. So a physician by profession, but he was a very significant influential proponent of medical humanism during this period. And in an essay titled Medical Humanism and Technologic Anxiety, that's an essay by Edmund Pellegrino. It was published in 1979. In this essay, Medical Humanism and Technologic Anxiety, he made clear his goals, you know, what he aims at. First, he said the humanities would help clarify the ethical issues and values at stake in clinical decisions. So he said humanities disciplines will help us, will help physicians clarify the ethical issues and values at stake in clinical decisions. Now, secondly, his goal was that the humanities would inculcate habits of critical self-examination. So critical consciousness as a central characteristic of humanities subject. This was emphasized and asserted by you know, Pellegrino. And he said, so a study of humanities would inculcate habits of critical self-examination. And thirdly, the humanities would confer those attitudes which distinguish the educated from the merely trained. So he made a distinction between education and training. And we, I mean, it's not very difficult for us to understand this distinction nowadays, right? Now, everybody is talking about this distinction between education and training, because we believe, I mean, because there are people who say under the name of the pandemic, there are people who really make use of the opportunity to, you know, boost and blindly, you know, promote online education. So there are people who also, in a counter argument, people argue that online education is not education. It's just training. You are just passing information. It's not education. Education is, you know, holistic development of, you know, students, etc., etc. So this distinction between education and training that he was also speaking of, probably, you know, Pellegrino was also talking about. So he said humanities would confer those attitudes which distinguish the educated from the merely trained, from the merely professional people. In short, he was emphatically confirming the need to blend humanities subjects with medicine. So his vision of humanistic education in medicine was that he recognized the need for scholarship and guidance from disciplines of the humanities. And today, Medical humanities draws on many disciplines, including history, literature, philosophy, religion, anthropology, sociology, and other arts and sciences. So medical humanities is a discipline that draws on all kinds of disciplines. You can't even say it's a discipline, probably a field of inquiry. So it draws on a number of other disciplines. And it draws on these disciplines in order to examine issues in the practice of medicine and healthcare. So medical humanities tries to bring to the forefront issues in the practice of medicine and healthcare. According to David Smith, the field also has an essential practical component because all medical humanities knowledge carries implications for the care of patients, the professional development of students, and the health populations. So David Smith, in an essay titled Quality, Not Mercy, Some Reflections on Recent Work in Medical Ethics. In this essay, he speaks about how medical humanities is not simply humanities. It also has an essential practical component because all medical humanities knowledge carries implications for the care of patients and then the professional development of medical students and also the health of populations. Now, Raimo Pustinen, Mikkel Lehmann, and Anna Maria Viljanen, three figures who wrote collectively an article titled Medicine and the Humanities, Theoretical and Methodological Issues. It was an article that was published in 2003. Now here, the authors point out that in the last half century, there has been a growing recognition in clinical medicine that the biological approach alone cannot address the various human phenomena that physicians encounter in their everyday practice. So the biological approach, that is the medical, conventional medical approach, you know, treating with medicine. So that conventional biological approach cannot actually address the human phenomena, the phenomena called human being. Whom the physicians encounter on an everyday basis. So they imply that there has been a growing tendency to see patients as not reduced to diseases and bodies, but rather as whole persons in contexts and relations. So their argument is that patients are not reduced anymore. Patients are no longer reduced to diseases and bodies, but persons are to be seen in context and in relations, which means in their cultural context, in the historical context, and in the context of their economic and political situations, etc. So they bring into the whole, they bring into medicine the whole idea of medical humanities as an interdisciplinary field of inquiry, where the patient is no longer simply a physical body or a disease. Instead, the patient is a person in context and relations. So the aim was to educate more humane physicians. So they say the introduction of medical humanities in the field of medicine is to educate more humane physicians and to recapture the notion of medicine as a learned profession, according to them. Now, one of the major characteristics of medical humanities is that it endeavors to bridge the gap between science and experience. This is a significant point of beginning for us. It tries to bridge this gap between science and experience, which means it relies on the philosophical distinction between disease and illness. Disease as different from illness. It's a distinction that philosophy would create. So medical humanities would rely on this distinction between disease and illness. Disease is what happens to the body and is understood through science, with the help of science. Illness is what the person experiences and is understood through eliciting patient stories, as well as by asking questions such as, what has this heart disease done to your family, etc. You know, so illness as different from disease. Medical humanities would clearly rely on this distinction between disease and illness. Disease is something that happens to the body, and it can be understood through science. But illness is linked to personal experience, and it is understood through eliciting patient stories. So you have patient stories, patient narratives, a number of patient narratives. You may have in your own language, you know. I really don't know what all languages you belong to, or those of you who are listening to me. So you may have narratives in your own language, patients narrating about their own experiences, you know, their own pain, their own agony, the experience of being a patient, for example. So, you know, such patient stories, and also questions like, you know, a kind of question that we started off with, that is, you know, what has this particular disease done to your family? You know, how it has it affected your family? How has a particular accident, for example, everything is fine, everything goes on well, suddenly, you know, someone meets with an accident, and then, you know, the whole thing changes, and probably sometimes the person is bedridden, sometimes, you know, a particular limb has to be removed, you know, and the whole thing changes the family, you know, how it actually affects the family. So you ask questions like this, and then illness has a, you know, a different dimension. It's not simply disease. So there are also other approaches to create this bridge between science and medicine, which also include reading stories about illness and also pathographies. You know, pathography is a subgenre of autobiography and biography, you can say. So you read stories about illness, not only narratives, but you also read stories about illness, you know, short stories and novels about people who undergo a particular kind of illness. Or you watch films and, you know, theatrical representations of illness. There may be such films, you know, where the protagonist of the film may be a bedridden person. You know, you can have people disabled, you know, in the sense the whole area that that has emerged recently, disability studies, for example, right? So representations of the disabled in films and in theatrical representations of illness, or viewing paintings and sculptures that represent the body in pain, you know, how you can represent pain through pictures and sculptures. So in medical humanities, a very significant theoretical question that is raised is, I mean, here I'm quoting Thomas R. Cole, an interesting author, author of works on medical humanities. So here, he observes that medical humanities ought to be regarded as integrating science and humanities in medical education. At the same time, humanity, or whether humanities simply should be added to a largely scientific medical education. This is a problem. He finds that this is a problem in medical humanities. That is, whether medical humanities ought to be regarded as integrating science and humanities within medical education. You integrate both these streams within medical education, or whether you simply add, you know, medical education is going on, and you simply add some humanities lessons also, a few stories, a few films to watch, you know, as part of their course, just do that. Which is the actual method? What strategy is best? Is something that is still debated within medical humanities. Now, let me quickly turn to the link between literature and medical humanities. Reading narratives of illness and stories of doctoring, you know, doctoring, or stories of doctors and treating, it expands our minds and sensibilities. According to medical humanities, when you read narratives of illness, when you read stories of, you know, doctors and treatment, it expands our minds and sensibilities and deepens fellow feeling. So that is why many of them demand that doctors should be trained within medical humanities. so that they have an ethical concern, they have an empathy for patients, they understand what patients are, you know, that kind of a situation. Towards the end of the talk, I'll be showing you two clips anyway, in order to, you know, talk about this further. So whether it is through poetry, fiction, or a memoir, you vicariously experience what others have undergone, and it widens our knowledge and experience of illness. You know, when you read such works, you know, the experience of being a cancer patient. We have a work in Malayalam, actually. So you read it and you vicariously understand what they may have undergone, you know, and it expands our knowledge of experience of illness. So in this sense, literature and the arts turn out to be a learning laboratory from where medical professionals can find the lives of the ill, their hurt and anxiety, at an imaginative level, of course. But still, they understand, medical professionals would understand the, you know, it becomes, art and literature becomes a learning laboratory for them, from where they learn about the lives of patients. Now, what it is to be a patient, what it is to be ill, you know, to be sick. So we may then begin to ask why, we can also ask, and in fact, medical humanities would ask a question, inquire into the reasons why sickness prompts us to storytelling. Why would sickness or illness make someone tell a tale, tell a story, you know, narrate it? You know, why would it prompt him or her to narrate it? Or how popular media influences our views about what it means to grow old, you know, or what it means to live with a disability, or to practice, sorry, or why it's important for doctors to try and merge medical and humanistic sensibilities. So these are all questions that medical humanities inquire into, you know. What makes a person narrate his or her tale? Or how popular media influences our views about what it means to grow old, for example, growing old, or what it means to live with a disability. So it's not only the experience of disability, but narratives of disability, whether visual or even written. So they also enhance our knowledge of the experience. So medical humanities inquires the ways in which we narrate our experiences of illness, and it discusses how narratives shape our experience of painful facts into intelligible and meaningful forms. So that's the significance of narratives. You know, narratives are very important in medical humanities. So the importance of narratives is that we may all have experiences. We may have undergone such painful experiences, but a narrative transforms the experience into intelligible and meaningful form. You try to have an understanding. You understand the experience better when you read a narrative. That's the assumption. So it considers how reading narratives of illness can improve our understanding of what it is to, you know, suffer, for example, you know, what it means to suffer. So what it means to suffer, or what it means to go through an illness, or what it means to you know, cope with an injury, you know. So this understanding, what it means, this understanding is improved by narratives. So this also helps, what do you say, professional doctors in dealing with patients, according to medical humanities. So we should also, I mean, that's where we see a subgenre of autobiography and biography known as pathography. Pathography, there are many such narratives, you know, pathographic writings where you have serious illness and injury, which are which interrupt the routine flow of our lives. We routinely live, and but suddenly a serious injury or serious illness, if it happens to one of us in the family, then it interrupts the routine flow of our lives. And such experiences may prompt us to shape them into a narrative of an experience of illness, a narrative of experience of illness. It becomes a narrative. It may prompt us to shape our experience into a narrative. And scholars call such a narrative a pathography. Call it pathography. And 20th century, in fact, has seen a number of pathographies, from different fields, a number of them. There are many such pathographies, particularly in English. And now, in the 1980s, the genre further expanded. And though memoirs, most of the memoirs were, all memoirs are in a way pathographies. So pathographies still continue to dominate even in 1980s, but there were also accounts of living with maladies of mind and body. That also began to appear in 1980s, living with maladies of mind and body, problems of mind and body, and living with such persons within the family, So these narratives also began to appear in 1980s. So according to Anne Hunsaker Hawkins, another person who has done extensive studies in this area, according to Hawkins, I quote, "Pathographies interpret experience, and they do so in a way that discloses certain important mythic attitudes about illness and treatment. Mythic thinking of all kinds becomes apparent in that delicate autobiographical transition from actual experience to written narrative. Since this transition is one that constructs necessary fictions out of the building blocks of metaphor, image, archetype, and myth." So Hawkins says pathographies are actually interpretations of experience. Definitely. You cannot take every memoir to be reality as such in that sense. But they are interpretations of experience, and they interpret within the light of already available metaphors, images, archetypes, and myths. So that's how they make sense of the feeling of pain, according to her. So her book titled "Reconstructing Illness: Studies in Pathography" is the work by Hawkins. And her book analyzes how authors of illness narratives rewrite their story in the light of received wisdom, captured in metaphors of journey and battle, myths of death and rebirth. So these are the images that probably the authors would use. And they transform harsh facts into intelligible and meaningful stories. There are many people who have done extensive work in this field, but I'm not going to get into them because we are running short of time, I suppose. So narratives, in short, are representations of earlier stories. And in the construction of narratives of illness, the writer tries to make sense of an experience by keeping it in the context of a larger narrative of suffering. So that's why I earlier quoted Hawkins, saying that narratives of illness are also interpretations. They are also representations, in other words. And the authors make sense of an experience by placing it in the context of a larger narrative of suffering and loss or healing, whatever. So you already have the narrative of healing, the narrative of loss, the narrative of suffering already available to you, either in written form, in visual form, or even in oral, as oral narratives. You already know about such narratives. So narratives of illness are also within this context. It's written within this context, and he or she gives a plausible account of what is happening now. That's what actually happens. So in this context, medical humanities perspective would raise a number of questions, like what it is about illness that prompts the impulse for reflection. So what makes one reflect about illness? What are some potential benefits of writing about illness? How and in what ways does narrative have the potential to heal? Does a narrative have the potential to heal? That's also a question that medical humanities would raise. So apart from the narratives of illness, there are also, you know, medical humanities is also influenced by cultural theories. And they critically look at visual media representations, like doctor shows, for example, you know, shows that actually, you know, portray doctors, or shows that portray, you know, disabled persons or persons with disability, then and so on. So these are doctor shows, you know, doctor saving life is a fascinating piece of, it's a fascinating story for many people, just like police stories, right? Two things that have always influenced people, police stories, you know, where you have murders and deaths, where doctor stories, most of which speak about saving life. So death and life, you know, these contrasts, we are probably fascinated by the two extremes in life, maybe. But so you have a number of such stories and shows, you know, visual on in the visual media, and you have such films as well. So medical humanities would inquire how such compelling portrayals of patients and doctors make questions of bioethics more accessible and important. Such portrayals, what role these portrayals of doctors and patients, what role do they play in raising questions of bioethics, in fact? So medical humanities would inquire into that, you know. And we are all familiar with, I'm sure you're all familiar with the American poet William Carlos Williams, right? Is associated with modernism and imagism and all that. And all of us probably have, I mean, studied his one very famous poem, you know, Red Wheelbarrow and things like that, right? So William Carlos Williams was actually a physician by profession. He was a physician, and he has also written a number of doctor-centered stories, which actually throw a very good light on doctors' sensitivity and sensibility. Or his some of his stories also speak about doctor-patient relationships as well. I mean, all these his stories can be found in a collection called The Doctor Stories. It is compiled by Robert Coles and published in 1984. All his doctor stories have been put into one book, compiled by someone else later on, of course. So in the writings of many physicians, we find a desire to think or to rethink on what they practice. So this is something that we generally notice in the writings of many physicians. They rethink on what they actually practice. So their descriptions, I'm not saying all the doctors do it, but some of the writings, you know, they often move beyond a mere description of doctoring, you know, doctoring as a specialized scientific knowledge or even technical, you know, expertise. They move beyond that, you know, the doctor stories move beyond this specialized field of knowledge and technical expertise. And instead, they seek a more broadened conception of their art, of their craft, in fact, you know, a more broadened kind of things like caring for their patients, and then reflecting and you know, writing about their experience of caring for patients. So all these are attempts to discover a required sensibility within medical profession itself. So I would now once again take you back to the 1960s in the United States, where medical students themselves actually were dissatisfied with the kind of medical education that they were undergoing. And many students found, and 1960s is a significant period because it's a period of student revolts in America. We all know that because we are all into, gender studies, feminism, and, you know, then we are familiar with the Black movement in America, etc. So 60s was a very significant period as far as America was concerned, a period of student revolts, in fact. So many of the medical school students found that the medical school culture was complicit in the injustices of the healthcare delivery system. They felt that healthcare had become a commodity rather than a right of people. And this sense of moral unease is very clearly expressed by one of the medical students in Philadelphia at this point of time. She wrote a poem titled On Being Poor. And I request the admins to please show that poem, On Being Poor, for the audience. Is it shown? Is it shown there, the poem? Can you see? I hope everybody can see.
It cannot be seen here.
Cannot be seen yet? Can you please show that poem?
Admin, can you please show that poem which was sent?
Or else it's okay. I'll just read it out. It's not, it's not an issue. We'll show the clips later on. Okay. So the poem is titled On Being Poor. Okay.
Sir, we'll ask the admin to screen the poem, sir.
Yeah.
Just a minute, sir. Just a minute.
Okay.
Sir, 2 minutes, sir. 2 minutes, sir.
Okay.
He was talking to me. We were in conference call. We are discussing the afternoon issues.
Oh, okay. It's fine.
He didn't notice it, sir. Sorry, sir.
Oh, it's okay.
2 minutes, sir.
Yeah. Yet.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes. This one.
Now we can see it.
Yeah, I can see. So this is a poem, written by L. Cron. She was actually a medical student, in Philadelphia at this time. It's titled On Being Poor, and the student says, she's a medical student, remember. Being poor is watching all the residents practice passing a laryngoscope down your dead baby's throat. The insensitive way in which doctors undergo, so you see that your dead baby's, your body is being, studied by doctors, that situation, that particular situation is something that she's talking about. Being poor, so it happens if you are poor because you invariably donate even your baby's body to the hospital. Being poor is being told in front of 115 people that you are a veritable museum of pathology. Being poor is coming to the emergency room at 10:30 a.m. with severe pain and not being seen until 1:30 p.m. in the clinic. You know, maybe things that we, some of us may have experienced as well, where doctors don't attend, even if you feel, you know, you feel very pained, you know, you undergo severe pain and doctors come and see in a very insensitive manner. It takes time for them to come. Being poor is having four young men put their fingers in your vagina and only one of them has his name and in MD. So there will be only one actual doctor, but everybody else, you know, learning on your body. Being poor is having a med student stick your arm seven times unsuccessfully while a staff physician stands by and watches. Being poor is being called stupid because you do not have the sense to feed your five kids more protein when you get only $3,100 a year. Being poor is being afraid to go to the hospital because you do not want to die. So this is, okay, you can close that screen. Okay. So that's, you know, so there were many students in this era who insisted that human values are a critical part of doctors' ability to care for patients. And that physicians have a responsibility to make the healthcare system fairer and to contribute generally to the betterment of society. So students, the whole movement actually came from medical students, we must remember. So they believe that doctors have a responsibility to the society. So many medical educators also at this time were critical of an education system which was better at training disease technicians, you know, they call them disease technicians, than educating thinking doctors. So they felt that the system was capable of creating, what do you say, disease technicians and not thinking doctors. You know, that was the attitude of, or that is the way in which they looked at the whole issue. So as a result, by 1980s, there were many within the field of medicine and even outside the field of medicine that expressed kind of suspicion, skepticism about this emphasis on bioscience alone, as far as medicine is concerned. Emphasis on bioscience and technology alone as adequate preparation for the practice of medicine. So people became suspicious of that. People were skeptical about this, I mean, the adequacy or skeptical about the sufficiency of, you know, bioscience and technology alone. So they called for an integration of cultural learning into medical education, in fact. And in short, I'm just trying to wind up very soon. In short, medical humanities would provide an interdisciplinary and interprofessional approach to the effects of illness and disease on patients. So it's not simply a doctor purely within the field of medicine, within the field of biomedicine, you know, approaching a patient, approaching disease. It's not simply that. Instead, an interprofessional and interdisciplinary approach towards the whole effect of illness and disease. And they study patients from that kind of a perspective. And the effect of illness and disease on health professionals, how it impacts them too, the health professionals. And the impact of illness in the social world in which both these people actually live, patients as well as professionals. So medical humanities is a broad, loose area of inquiry that would that simultaneously demands its presence within medicine, because doctors have to be trained within medical humanities as well in order to be good professionals. At the same time, it's also a critical inquiry into understanding illness, human psychology, etc. At the same time, there are also, of late, there are critical medical humanities scholars emerging. No? There is also, within the field of medical humanities, there are also people who are known as scholars, who are known as critical medical humanities scholars, like people like Anne Whitehead or Angela Woods. You know, these are all significant figures in the field of critical medical humanities. And they raise certain other important issues as well, along with these issues in medical humanities. They also talk about certain omissions that have happened within medical humanities itself. And that is, according to them, a focus, you know, traditional medical humanities inquiry focused on the lived body of the cancer patient. For example, cancer patient, not only cancer patient, but any patient. They just use this as an example. So the lived body of the cancer patient, or so what happens, or the patient himself or herself. The focus is on the patient. But they say that is not enough for medical humanities. Critical medical humanities would ask us to pay more attention to the dimensions of gender, class, race, sexuality, etc. within medical humanities. So is the patient ahistorical? No. Is the patient, not a social being? He or she is a social being. So gender, patient, the patient as a, I mean, patient as woman and patient as man. No, what changes would happen? What happens when the patient is a woman? What happens when the patient is a man? I mean, what effects it has on the family, society, and how the patient-doctor relationship is, etc. So many questions are immediately raised when you think of the patient as a woman, or patient as a man, so, or patient as transgender, in other words. Nowadays, they raise all these issues. So medical humanities, according to critical medical humanities scholars, traditional medical humanities has focused only on the patient or the lived body of the patient. But we need to pay more, according to them, we need to pay more attention to dimensions of gender, class, race, sexuality, etc. within this field. So they also speak about the absence of focus on non-medical notions of health. How medical humanities, traditional medical humanities, is concerned only about medical notions of health, but how we need to pay more attention to non-medical notions of health, probably cultural notions of health, that has to be addressed within medical humanities. So non-medical notions of health, illness and well-being, you know, what it means to be well, you know, to be fine, what it means to be ill, you know. So it's not simply the medical, criteria that matters, but even non-medical criteria. Cultural, notions about health and well-being that also need to be taken into consideration very seriously, according to. So, therefore, critical medical humanities ask questions such as how might the bodies of doctors and patients be marked in terms of race, class, gender, ability and disability, and with what effects? That's a significant question that critical medical humanities would ask. Now, I would like to show you two clips from a movie, a film called The Doctor, that was released in 1991. So I'll just give you a very brief idea about the film, because from the scenes, you cannot make out the entire story anyway. Here, what you have is The Doctor. Some of you may have watched the film earlier. Here you have Dr. Jack McKee, who is a very successful surgeon and leads a very fine life, very successful surgeon. He's in a surgeon in a leading hospital, and he works hours together. He works even late night, that he rarely has time to see even his son. So he's very busy. But the film also shows you in the beginning how insensitive the doctor is, Jack McKee, because, his bedside manners, as they call it, you know, bedside manners of a patient, when the doctor approaches the patient, that bedside manners are lacking in him. You know, it's very insensitive and not bothered about the patient. He's a very successful surgeon, of course, and even his conversations in the operation theater with fellow doctors and all that. It's very, you know, casual. And even to the patient, when he speaks, he's very casual. All that is shown in the beginning. And then one day, what happens is he coughs and he vomits blood. And then he goes to a doctor. So, and it is discovered that he has a growth in the throat, and biopsy becomes positive for cancer. And the whole experience of suddenly becoming a patient, till yesterday he was a doctor, and now today he becomes a patient. Now with cancer. So, and then his time spent with, and then he begins to really look at how his doctor is behaving with him, you know, his doctor who does the diagnosis, who is actually treating him, and how insensitive the doctor is. So he understands, he begins to understand what it means to be a patient, and how he changes in the end, how he makes his interns, you know, his interns, how he makes them sometimes wear patient gowns and assigns them various illnesses and orders all the tests for them to feel the experience that they will soon put their patients through, you know. So he wants his, later on, once he recovers, he wants his interns to also undergo this experience, what the patients would undergo. I will just show you two clips, okay? We'll come back after that. Yeah, please show those clips, admin.
Can you, Professor, can you see the screen?
You can see the screen, but it's stuck, I think, right? Maybe, it's okay. But sound, maybe that's a problem here.
Where is the audio?
But I need to probably increase its volume. I hope everybody can hear, you know, the audio is okay on your side.
Actually, audio is not there, I think.
Oh, what happened? No audio, yeah, that's what people are saying. What is wrong with the audio?
One minute, sir, let me increase it from my side and check it again.
Yeah, okay.
The second video is playing now.
Okay. Even that, let's see. Okay, you can close it.
Announcement, speaker, sir, it has been loaded in our channel also. This okay. Two videos, they can see it there also.
Okay, I'll give the details of the film. They can later on watch. No problem. I'll give the details right now.
Admin, you remove the screen.
Okay. So, this was a film that was, released in 1991, as I told you, The Doctor. You just, Google it and you will find it, The Doctor. That's the movie, The Doctor, 1991. So, and the scenes actually, the first clip actually, explains the kind of shock that he experiences when the doctor says, when his doctor says there is a growth, we'll send it for biopsy and all that, you know. And suddenly he just cannot probably believe, you know, that it would happen to him. And then later on in the second one, the second clip actually shows how his doctor behaves with him, how insensitive. So he undergoes, but he doesn't shout back. That was not the kind of person he was actually, but he doesn't shout back. And he very patiently he understands how a doctor should be, how a doctor should behave. So what I'm trying to say is, these are just small clips. So the clips wouldn't tell you much about the film at all. And I would request everybody in the audience to probably go and watch this film. It's an interesting film. It speaks about what is lacking in medical profession. For them, it's biomedicine. For many, it's biomedicine and simply, you know, sickness or illness is a question of biomedicine and technology. That's all. And the human side is absent. That's the idea. So how a medical profession is becoming increasingly commercialized, increasingly insensitive, etc. And to retrieve the sensitivity of medical profession, or to unearth the sensitivity that was probably there in medical profession, that's why many medical schools in the United States actually have introduced courses in medical humanities. In fact, it's not simply about ethics. It's not simply about questions of ethics, but how you interact, how you treat, how you understand illness itself. That's a question. That's a basic question. How do you understand illness? Is it a question of physical health alone, or is it something else? So such a wide area that needs further exploration. And I told you right in the beginning that I'm a very minor student in this field. I was just trying to share with you some of the things that I found after my reading in this area. So I hope it was of some use to all the participants. And thank you very much for listening to me. So we can have a discussion if you have anything to ask.
Thank you very much, Dr. Saji Matthew, for that very wonderful session where you explained what medical humanities is, and you traced a bit of its history, and also spoke about how it plays a role with regard to literature too. There have been a lot of questions from our participants regarding the various points that you spoke about. We'll just focus on a few because we are also running short of time. To begin with, this is from Mr. Ahmar Alvi. When humanism was challenged, entailing an explosion of theories, how did it become possible that medicine and humanities intersected, resulting into medical humanities?
Okay, I'll answer one by one. That's better, I suppose, right? Instead of taking all the questions together. One thing is, that's why that's why I said it's an irony that humanities was actually being reinvented, by people who were concerned about medicine, of course. But then at the end of my talk, I also talked about critical medical humanities, right? So probably that is where the questioning of that so-called humanism and humanities in 1960s refigured within medical humanities itself. It would come back in a different fashion and say that it's not simply a patient and his or her body alone, but instead the body is not asocial. The body is historical. The body is social, cultural. So the body is man, woman, or transgender. The body is black or white. The body is something else. So these questions have to be incorporated into. So a traditional humanistic kind of approach within medical humanities would not be of any use. That is the stand that critical medical humanities would take. So I think that critical medical humanities is precisely widening the scope of medical humanities from a traditional kind of intersection between medicine and humanities. I hope I tried to answer the question.
The other question is, can we say that counseling done by psychiatrists or psychotherapists is a manifestation of medical humanities? And maybe in connection with that, there is one more from Ms. Nina Gupta, who asked, could recent cases of suicides due to depression or isolation have been prevented if a medical humanities narrative had been created on time?
I would answer that second question first. I would really agree with that. You know, I can't say for sure that if in a narrative of medical humanities were already created, suicides wouldn't have taken place and all that. I'm not going to say make such a statement, but I would definitely say such things would really, you know, help the society a lot. You know, though I can't say whether that would have stopped suicide cases. You know, in our society, I cannot say that. And the other thing is. What was that? As counseling, yes. I think definitely we can include such, but they are not recorded. That's the issue. You know, counseling done by psychiatrists and psychologists are not usually recorded and you know, handed out. So, but what they do, what they practice, is a kind of medical humanities. Of course, I think so. Especially well, I mean, when a counseling is happening, taking place. You know, palliative care, for example, you know, for cancer patients, you know, that's also an example of medical humanities in a way.
Then this is with regard to, you know, certain other areas that could be related. Like, from Devayan Das, this question is, can disability studies be included in the paradigm of medical humanities? Then from Ms. Renu, can we include pandemic literature in medical humanities? You know, that kind of those questions.
Okay, like, I think we can. I mean, it all depends on how you want to broaden the field, you know. So because disability studies, of course, it can be included under medical humanities. Then, and particularly under critical medical humanities, I would say. And then pandemic literature, of course, pandemic literature would, because, you know, you talk about, you know, when the recent pandemic started spreading everywhere, people in fact started talking about Decameron and all that, right? Immediately. I think, you know, if you talk about such a text from the past, from such a century, I think, you know, it speaks about how consciously the people want to escape from the thought about a pandemic, you know. So they are narrating story every day, you know, running away into a village, people get together and every day somebody narrates a story. And this activity that you find in a text like Decameron is a psychological anxiety to, you know, forget the reality of a pandemic that is there. And they were running away from that. So if you want to, in that sense, pandemic literature definitely can be included under, you know, medical humanities, or even literature about, I mean, that's something that I mentioned earlier, you know, literature about doctors and patients, hospitals, and all that, you know, it can be definitely.
And, again, two related questions. This is from Ms. Judith. How does medical humanities differ from traditional healing practices of the indigenous people who believe in a holistic approach to heal a person? And, you know, related to that, there is another question from Dr. Rajesh Kundalge, our colleague in the university. Why are we so averse towards the efforts made by Siddha and Ayurveda or any other indigenous medical systems in finding a cure to COVID-19? Can it be taken as an example of medical hegemony?
Okay, let me try to respond to the first question. That is a holistic approach, right? Isn't it? Is that that was that the first question?
Yeah, traditional healing practices.
Traditional healing. Yeah, medical humanities. I mean, I wouldn't say medical humanities is nothing more than traditional healing practices, but that is precisely what medical humanities is indirectly saying. That you cannot simply talk about you know, illness as kind of, you know, biomedical issue. Illness is not simply a biomedical issue. You need to have a holistic approach towards the patient and illness. So traditional healing practices would not be kept out, definitely. Now the whole point is, at the same time, there is also an element that somewhere along the way I also talked about the practical application realm of you know, medical humanities. So there, the thing is, the whole problem of medicine is that it has to be tested and proved, right? So how do you test? Now, recently, only the other day, central government has asked Patanjali to stop the advertisements, right? Where did you test? Which hospital? What are the evidences of your medicine being capable of curing COVID-19 and things like that, they asked. So the whole thing, the whole issue is that is at the level of curing and healing. But medical humanities is not simply about, transferring medicine and then healing it, but understanding the patient's experience, addressing the psychological and cultural aspect of his experience of illness, his or her experience of illness. So the patient is not just a body, but the patient has to be understood in a holistic manner. In that sense, you can definitely say such medical systems would be very much happy with, happy with having a friendship with medical humanities, definitely. But then it's a holistic approach, not about curing alone. It's not simply about healing, but rather than healing, it is about understanding the patient's experience, and how you transact between the patient and the doctor, or between the patient and the family members, all that, or the society itself, when there is a patient, when there is a COVID-19 affected person in a village, what would be the neighbor's reaction immediately, is a question. For example, I can tell you the place where I live right now, my house near the university, maybe some 500 meters away, some 400 meters away from my house, there is a quarantine center that is university hostel. Actually, the university's hostels, okay? So hostels are being, converted into, they have been for quite some time, people who have come from abroad, they have been quarantined there. So what happens is, someone who comes to my house, on a regular basis almost, from a different place, he no longer comes there because he fears that if he enters the road, the road that goes to the quarantine center, he can be affected. So how in a situation of illness or disease or fear of illness and disease, in such a situation, how, society responds to it, what happens to the psychological makeup of people. Well, these are more important for medical humanities, than curing, actual medicine. That is the business of medicine, that's the actual medicine, whatever kind of system you use. Then regarding the other question, I don't know where there is a hegemony. I think there is a hegemony of allopathy. I do believe there is. But the problem is, I can't say who is responsible. One of the problems is that research, actual medical research in other systems of medicine has to be promoted more. Research has to be promoted more, medical research. What is happening in allopathy is that a lot of research is taking place even in universities, not necessarily in medical colleges and all that, even in universities, in biosciences and elsewhere. A lot of research in this field, as a result of which that increases the credibility of allopathy, or what we generally call English medicine and things like that. But I would say such researches should be promoted in other systems of medicine, and they should be able to, or even interdisciplinary approach is possible. For example, some time ago, even homeo doctors and Ayurvedic doctors would not even advise you to go for a lab test or take an x-ray or anything like that. But nowadays they do. So this is just technology, as though technology is the monopoly of allopathy medicine. Technology can't be the monopoly of allopathy medicine. If you can detect, diagnose something, then you may have a medicine in your own system. So this interdisciplinary approach is required, not only on the part of allopathy, but I would say even others, others would say, oh, allopathy is nothing, you can't do anything. It's just about, cutting and stitching, things like that. Nothing about, curing or healing, they would say. That's not the kind of approach that probably we should take, I believe.
Okay. Yeah, this is another question from Mr. Gurshik, Ms. Gurshik Kaur. What does medical humanities have to say about medical tourism? One, about the new business of aesthetic rectification of dental settings or plastic surgery and
Exactly.
of zero figure related issues.
Yeah, yeah. I actually, yeah. Actually, medical humanities, I didn't talk about that. Actually, that's a significant area within medical humanities, our notions of body, in fact, you know. How so we even otherwise we have you know we study or issues related to body representation of body or our conceptualizations of body etc. So but body is also body politic, you know, as we say, body politics is also a significant aspect of medical humanities, you know, how we understand body, cosmetic surgeries, for example, plastic surgeries, you know, these are all issues that medical humanities would definitely, you know, address, you know, looking at it from the whose interests are actually, if you have critical medical humanities position, then in a cosmetic surgery, in a plastic surgery, which genders interests are actually fulfilled, all these questions are naturally raised, and you can always include it under medical humanities, and they do. Then regarding medical tourism, of course, you can of course include that under medical humanities if you want to, definitely. Talking about, you know, transnational capitalism, definitely transnational capitalism. In fact, COVID-19 has also proved to us that transnational capitalism and movement of people are the major cause of the spread of COVID-19, right? Actually, the spread on such a wide scale.
We've exceeded our time. Just one or two questions and then I think we can conclude. This is from Ms. Shamli, who is asking, what is your take on the tendency of films, especially Indian films, to either dehumanize or romanticize or victimize patients and disease? Do these visual narratives heal or further worsen the situation? And as an answer, she also has asked another question. Should film people be given training in the field of medical humanities?
I think so. You can. I don't know whether it's possible, but you know, it's not simply about filmmakers, you know, being given training. It's about you know, society's attitude. Actually, it's about society's attitude. How your attitude is towards persons with disability, for example. You know, that could be even psychological disabilities as well. So how do you actually treat them? Or till recently, you can say, I mean, what the participant has raised is a significant issue, because all narratives need not be experiential narratives. All narratives are not, you know, they are simply representations. So you have to critically look at them, of course. You have to critically look at them and critique such representations, definitely. How, for example, transgenders were shown till recently in films, in other words, you know, or whoever is different from me is not normal, you know, kind of attitude. So, that has to be questioned, that has to be challenged, definitely. So, so all films need not be showing a real experiential kind of narratives, but such films actually give us ample scope to understand how you know, society needs a change, to think about the need for a change in terms of their conceptualizations of body, or you know, how certain black bodies are used in our films. I'm not quite familiar with all the films in India, because all the films in India, in the sense, Indian films are in multiple languages, right? So I'm not quite familiar with all of them, but at least in Malayalam film, I know how there is serious problem with the use of black body, in fact, you know, and how it is a butt of ridicule in Malayalam films, film industry itself. And in that way, it is very racist and casteist, in a sense, you can say. So, all those issues can be raised. And medical humanities, therefore, is not simply a separate discipline. That's why I would say it is an interdisciplinary area, a field of inquiry, you know, where many of the things that we have been doing in cultural studies could also be part of medical humanities as well, I think. So it's only recently that we have started thinking about persons with disability while constructing buildings, for example, right? Until then, nobody thought about that. Or even left-handers, we still don't think about left-handers. I always say this because my daughter is a left-hander. So what happens is, what is natural to left-handers is that if you want to open a door, you know, you have the latch and you move it. You move it to one side, you move it to the left. But a left-hander would have the natural inclination, that's what I feel, you know, from what I've seen in her, natural inclination to move it to the other side, which is locking. Okay, so technology, materials, everything is made in our society for the use of the majority, you know, that suits the convenience of the majority, not the different, and not, you know, people with a different approach, etc. So if you open a bottle like this, you know, to drink water, we would naturally, with the right hand, we would naturally turn it to the left. But she wouldn't do that initially. But now she's able to. But what I'm saying is, the natural inclination would be to turn it to the other side, which is tightening it. So the whole thing is made, everything in the society is made in order to suit the interest and convenience of majority, actually.
Maybe just one more. I'm just paraphrasing this, okay, from multiple questions. Medical humanities and literary research in India.
Okay.
What is your take on that?
That is something which I think hasn't happened much. I mean, I have nothing against it. Of course, I would promote it. I mean, what else can I say when you, when somebody asks me what is my take in the sense? Of course, it is not a, you know, blossomed field. It is probably an emerging field, and there is much to do it, of course. Not only literature, even visual media as well, you know, clubbing medical humanities and visual media or literature, there is a lot to do it. There are novels about medicine, about doctors, about hospitals, experience of, you know, or even autobiographies. In Malayalam, actually, we have a writing by Innocent and all, right? Cancer Ward Lechiri, that's the title of the text. So where he had, he's an MP now. So he had undergone, you know, this, I mean, not now in the sense, he was an MP. So he had cancer, and what he speaks, he's also an actor, film actor. So a comedian in a way. So he speaks about the laughter in a cancer ward. You know, that's a book about himself, his experience of being a patient. So such works are to be studied, in fact, and see and understand how patients, you know, feel and react to a system. I think there is a lot of scope for research in the area.
Okay, Dr. Saji, thank you very much for your lecture. It's really interesting and enlightening also, as it is an emerging field, especially in India. And I guess our participants would have benefited a lot from the information that you gave during your talk, and there were a lot of questions, maybe, you know, close to 100 or more. I've just taken few questions more. So we are really grateful that you were able to join us for this international e-workshop and share your knowledge in this field with us. Thank you very much for it. Thank you, participants, for patiently listening to the lecture. I understand from your comments and questions that it was really very beneficial for you, especially since it's a new and emerging area. We will join again in the afternoon. The link for the afternoon session will be generated shortly.
Yes, sir, there is a few announcements from the host side, sir. Shall I announce?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Dear participants, good afternoon to all of you. Sharing the link for the afternoon session is getting delayed. Just an hour before, only an hour before, we got the video from the resource person from South Africa, but we are quite shocked. It is too lengthy, 2 hours and 7 minutes. So at the same time, it is now it's a time-consuming process. We have to now merge it, then we have to compress it, merge it, then upload it, then we have to generate the link. So it is a time consuming process. It will take some time, so please bear with us, but we try our best to send it before 3 o'clock. and maybe on a, at least a half hour before the session starts. And one more announcement that it's a request from the host side, please prepare your mind, all the participants prepare your mind to stay connected to us till 5 or 5:15 in the afternoon session. And because he has sent us a lengthy video and which runs to two hours and 7 minutes. And another announcement is that the South African resource persons will be available with us from 3 o'clock onwards. Along with this, he will be also watching the video in YouTube. And for the interactive session, he will join us on Zoom platform at probably at 4:45 or 5 o'clock. The last half an hour, we have interactive session. So we try our best, I know, to send it at the earliest and prepare your mind. Go and have lunch and prepare your mind to stay back with us for 2 hours for the afternoon session. Thank you so much. Thank you, Banu sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Saji sir, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll meet in the afternoon.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.